Hi, I'm Adam Holz, and this is
Paul Asay.
Today, we are going to be talking about Avengers Infinity War, and my goodness, Paul, is there a lot to talk about?
We are going to be getting into spoilers, so just to let you know, if you haven't seen it and you want to see it, watch this
Pause.
Podcast later.
This is your moment. Pause and come back later.
Yeah, because we have a lot to talk about here. It's one of those movies when, after the ending happened, you have all the credits, you sit to the end of the credits, I was kind of grieving at that point.
I mean,
you know, there was mourning going on for me.
There was for me, too. And this is going to sound really weird, but I felt like the same way I felt after I watched Schindler's List.
Which is crazy.
Saving Private Ryan. I mean, these movies that just deliver an emotional gut punch. And I knew that there was going to be one coming.
Right.
But, you know, sort of like how Luke Skywalker in Last Jedi says, this is not going to go the way you think.
Right.
This movie did not go the way I thought.
I don't think. You know, because you're right. I think that we were all prepared for Iron Man to die, Captain America to die. We were expecting one of the characters that we had sort of grown to know and love to sacrifice his life for this greater cause. I was not expecting the swath of superheroes that we saw.
Yes.
And I think that this was even worse. The bad guy looks like he won.
He wins.
Yeah.
And just like Last Jedi subverts some things we've come to expect from Star Wars, this subverted everything you expect from a superhero movie. You expect the good guys to get pushed to the brink, somebody comes up with a great plan, somebody else sacrifices, boom, bad guy goes off to wherever bad guy goes to, you know, the Phantom Zone, I know that's DC, but whatever, and happily ever after, right?
Right.
No. Basically, Thanos wins. And not only does Thanos win, at the snap of a finger, he turns half the cast into dust.
Right.
Literally, before your eyes, they just disintegrate.
And these characters that you know and care for. I thought that the worst one for me, Spider-Man and Iron Man. Watching
Spider-Man.
That was really hard to watch.
Poor kid. He's dead now.
Or is he?
Dun, dun, dun. Well, let's get into that.
Yeah.
Because I think the thing I walked out feeling was, this was a pretty amazing superhero movie that deals with all sorts of moral and spiritual complexities.
Right.
But it ended in a place where, after I got done being shocked, I got kind of mad because I felt a little bit manipulated.
Sure.
Because, spoiler warning again, they're not going to leave Spider-Man, Black Panther, and the Guardians of the Galaxy dead.
Right.
That's about $5 billion Disney dollars sitting on the table.
Right.
And
right.
I think most of those films already have sequels in production at this point. So then the question becomes, how are they going to bring him back in the next Avengers movie? Because just like you can't leave Superman dead, Spider-Man's not staying dead, folks.
Yeah, no.
Ain't going to happen.
And it's a tricky
thing.
You know, and I know that the comic books are notorious for this. You know, they bring
comic
back
books.
These characters, and there's sometimes, I was talking with my daughter, who's a big Marvel fan, about this very issue, and she was talking about how it seems cheap when you have all these characters who die and then they come back. It feels like, it does rob, I think that your sense of anger is really valid, because it does rob the story of its power in some
ways. Its gravitas is not there. Because you're like, all right, these guys are all dead.
Yeah.
And I wonder how they're going to bring them back. There's a curiosity there. I mean, my guess is that the next one will make even more money than this one did, because we all want to know,
well,
how are they going to pull this off?
Yeah, no, it's one of those movies where I am already counting down the days until the next one, because you leave in such a...
You got your nerd card totally punched on that, right?
Yeah, no, this is...
That's all right.
Probably
I'm right there with you.
Yeah, it's a tricky thing. It's interesting, though, because when I look at the ending here,
mm-hmm.
while it left you angry, and I totally understand that, I walked away feeling... I took it from a more spiritual bent, you know?
Because you're a better person than I. I go straight to anger. True. Paul starts thinking about Jesus, well, and that's the difference between us.
But it really is. It reminds me kind of this waiting period. We know that there's another Avengers movie coming. But in that moment, and when we saw our heroes turn to dust, it didn't really matter. Right. And for me, that it made me think of how the disciples may have reacted on Saturday, you know, between Good Friday and Easter Sunday, where you feel like this, the Son of God, the man who you've been following all this time, who is supposed to be the world savior, is lying dead in a tomb, and you forget for a moment that he's already said he's coming back.
Right.
You know, and you have this really anxious, grieving time where it feels like everything you've been working for has come to naught. And for me, in a way, that's the way this movie felt at the end, where I've reviewed a lot of these movies.
Yeah, dude, you've written books on this stuff.
I've written books on this. I'm pretty heavily invested in this universe. So when it happened, I felt that emptiness. I thought, has this whole thing that I've invested so much time for come to naught? And it was a very interesting reaction. But it did lead me to think about the Avengers. The Avengers coming up feels like, in some ways, hopefully a redemption of that, where we have hope for that next morning coming on the horizon.
Where we have characters making sacrifices that stick this time.
Exactly. And in some ways, this movie, this is another area where I think you and I sort of differ. It felt like it was really...
I'll be the judge of that.
It felt like a really life-affirming movie to me, because you have...
Amidst all the death, yes.
Amidst all of the death. Because you have Thanos, who is very calculatingly saying, the universe would be a much better place without half the people, right? So let's just kill him. In a way, you have these superheroes saying, listen, these people, you may not know them, but they have life, they have souls, they have importance, they love. And that was really a key thing for me in this movie, was that whole concept of love. And so because of that, it said, listen, even when it's very difficult, and when you know that some of these things are real issues, you know, we do live in a universe, in a world of finite resources. Life is worth preserving. Yes. Life is worth saving. Life is worth protecting at any cost.
And, you know, related to that, I thought one of the interesting moments is where Vision, who's an android or synthezoid, if you want to get real geeky, offers to give his life. Because Thanos needs the crystal that's in his head. And so everybody's trying to protect him and keep that from happening. And Captain America says, we don't trade lives. And that's an interesting moment, because I'm like, well, people sacrifice all the time. So on one level, I didn't even quite buy it.
Right.
But he was basically saying, we're not going to make that sacrifice if we don't have to.
Right.
We are going to do everything we can to avoid that outcome.
Yeah.
And there's... that I think a deep value placed on life. Whereas Thanos, even though he has these high-minded sounding, you know, ideas about, well, it'll be better for everybody else, for my money, maybe the most brutal scene in the movie is the scene on Gamora's planet when she's a child and they gun down all those people. And just by way of warning, we've talked about death a lot here.
Right.
There are a lot of people who die a lot of different ways in this movie, and I think it's still worth... you know, saying that's something to take really seriously if you have young fans of this, because
it's
something that I think could really affect them, and they may not be able to process it on a level that, you know, adults
no
could.
Absolutely not. I mean, this is something that I wrote in the review. I think the content that you see here is not technically much more extreme than what we've seen in previous superhero movies. You know,
but emotionally,
it can be wrecking, particularly for kids who are really invested in this universe.
And for you,
and for me, for adults who are really invested in this universe. You know, it's just a hard movie to watch, and I think that it's one of those things. We say this all the time at Plugged In, but I think it's really valuable to repeat. As parents, you need to be talking with your kids all the time about the stuff that they consume, the stuff that they watch, the stuff they listen to, and that has never been more true in this. You need to set aside some time to process this movie, to, if you choose to take your family to see it, make sure you set aside some time to actually talk about some of the issues, because there's a ton of issues to go through here.
And, you know, there are some positive and redemptive themes here. I think it was a well-crafted film, but I just want to, you know, reiterate what you just said.
Absolutely.
It's one that is going to leave you probably in a pretty thoughtful, quiet place, because it's a hard movie.
It's a hard movie. And there you go.
And there you go. I'm Adam Holtz.
I'm Paul Asay.
And for the official Plugged In Vodcast, we thank you for tuning in today and invite you to share your comments below.